census information to investigate and bring back. Number seven.
Alright, sign on. So, this item is for the purchase of a new equipment trailer. Again, to be used by all the utility departments. Its primary function would be to move the scissor lift and the excavator around town. We don't currently have a trailer that can move the scissor lift. I use my own trailer for the scissor lift. We're trying to get away from the good. Again, this is not to exceed. To negotiate a better trailer, I have found some other trailers. Unfortunately, they're a little farther away, so if you can negotiate a better price, you can bring it here and have their specifications that they provided don't have everything we need, so we probably have to have them order something. They will work to suit our needs the best. But the price range basically ranges from $7,600 to $9,600. And unfortunately, the $9,600 ones are closer to the brand. On trailers, that's one thing I really am not going to budge on. Trailers are something that gets used and reused, and really don't know how bad it is until it's we have a current quote. We have a recent current quote from Trailer Barn, previous trailer farm, there's a company called Bandero, Bandaro, probably pushing it, but equipment in the valley in Fresno, and they actually have a quote by $7,600. There's another company. Pass Robles on NGMC, whatever that's what it's called. They have one that's around $7,600, but doesn't matter. So, or and play one against the other.
Open trailer?
It's a flatbed trailer. I don't know if you've seen one of the car association has, but it'll be very
similar.
I was hoping that. Part of what we need to make sure is that this is what can actually get up onto it. So a heavy angle on it, it's not going to work. It has to have basically a knife edge of the tail and a low enough portion of it. Think a little approach. So that it can climb up on itself. The hydraulic tail. Depending on what the angle is, we may have to have a winch. If you can't get down on the load, then we'll have a winch to pull the system up. In order for the tractor and the excavator to be on it individually, it needs to be at least 20 feet by 8 feet by, or 20 feet by 8 feet. Without a
nose on
it. New axle. New axle.
So, what if you had the place for use long X that the system has promised you to
It's possible.
Yeah. What you build, what you get, as opposed to.
Yeah.
The
I don't think it'd be a problem finding that trailer. Getting it at a lower cost. The issue is just finding one that has the conversion to get it up on. That size and that type of trailer are all over the place. Just making sure it works. Well, it's similar to a car trailer. It's generally the rear porch has tilt trailers because car trailer would be generally fixed at the, some sort of ramps and whatever. So that, that's kind of standard success. We could find something to go ramps up to it. And the other coming out is on the field. It's all the field to get up there. The issue would be how long the ramps would have to be, how heavy they would be, and making sure they have proper support, because that's
Kirkpatrick Box?
Yes.
Director Collins?
Yes.
Director Gregory?
Yes.
President Sangster?
Yes.
Group 4, 0, 1 absent.
Secondary note, I need to provide some sources for changes.
I'd be happy to have the excerpt for you.
I'll move on to item 8. Declaring meets public nuisance within San Diego Community Service District for Resolution 2020-20. Staff recommends the board approve Resolution 2020-20. Declaring meets a hazardous nuisance, direct staff to receive the money. Notice is for paid. But attached is the date.
Stop.
But.
That's not what we're doing. So number 8 reads, we're going to adopt Resolution 2020 operates in abatement of the nuisance under this account.
Okay,
that was from last month. I guess the staff report didn't change, but the item is
to abate.
Actually abate.
It says to abate.
One says there have to meet the
they have to just have to strike those to proceed to abate. So I would say we have to amend with notices.
this much an hour, but it didn't specify if it's this much an hour with the weed whacker, this much an hour with the tractor, this much an hour with the truck, so it was not viable to ask for the part of plus the price. So currently, Martinelli and Mr. Staff are within pennies of each other as far as the manpower, but there's a lot of variables as far as the district staff versus Martinelli. Having conversations with the director of Dodds, we feel it might be in our best interest to have Martinelli that's taking to the tractor work, and then the weed whipping work, and then we need to be able to shoot the chainsawing. Then we do it in-house because we do have a shipper. The price of the shipper was quite a bit more. So the recommendation is to approve. This is the long resolution. Okay. So approve resolution 2020-23 authorizing the direct utilities. No, that's not about.
Read the recommendation.
I'm going to do the long part. Let me go back to number 8. 2020-20. Staff requests the board and holds discussion to consider objections to the notes to remove, destroy, and abate vegetation, rubbish, and debris. Overrule any objections and adopt resolution 2020-20, authorizing the fire chief to allocate abatement work performed. So it's slightly different from the staff report, basically the same thing. Somebody's out there Monday morning cutting their weeds, and we have to see some assistance in the market, and that's probably. And then that goes to the get a tally, that photographs before and after, and then the contractor gives us their estimate for their bill for what they've done from the time now, and that is the tax.
We'll approve that tax next time.
Any board comment? Any public comment?
Resolution and it's revising a budget adjustment of $2,500 for testing of existing non-district wells that have complications for doing fishery wells. Essentially, what we're trying to do is take water quality data from non-district private wells around essentially the south. south end of San Miguel and the west side of San Miguel to determine where a suitable site for a new well would be. We have a general idea of where in the district we can put wells. This information will be compiled with the information we already have from the wells from Dino Farms, which is up by Portside Sellers, the information we have from Fort Hart from Gallo, and some of the well information we have from the east side, so that we can paint a bigger and better picture of what the quality of the water is in different parts of town, so we can get a more defined picture of where a new well should be located. Right now we have 10 wells that we're looking at testing. They're all the same southern half of San Miguel, except for two. We're trying more than it, but that will fill in where our gaps are. Each well is approximately $1,500 for all the testing.
In the staff proportion of the state, each well would cost approximately $10,500 to take the amount of it.
Sorry, that's a typo. That should be $1,000. We're only asking for $10,000.
That was the question we're asking for, $100,000.
Well, eventually we're going to come back for $100,000, but that's going to be a more significant exercise.
Questions from the board?
So this will be able to figure, so we'll do the testing and then be able to figure out where we can possibly put the next new well. Not looking at if there's any existing wells that might meet our standards.
So these are all wells that are either on private property as a domestic well,
mm-hmm.
or for instance the Mission well, which is, we're not going to develop a well on the Mission.
Mm-hmm.
Or on the school, or we're not going to develop a well on the school. So these are all wells that we know exist, and we can get data on them and drill depth and their makeup.
Okay.
And we have the geology makeup of the area, so we can know what the water quality is in that particular area.
How far south are we going outside of San Miguel? Are we just talking like just outside the district boundaries?
So the farthest south that we are looking right now is the cemetery.
Okay.
Actually, I guess the Caldonio would be itself. Part of what we're looking at in the overall picture is what is reasonably attainable. Farther south or north or east or west in the district may be better water quality, but if we have to spend $5 million getting there,
yeah.
Then it's not financially viable. So all of these wells will fill in, like I said, a picture of what the water quality is in and directly around the district, so that we'll have a better picture today for a new well that we need relatively immediately, and we'll have a good picture so in the future, when we develop future wells or looking at additional sources, then we have that data.
Okay. So when would we anticipate new well?
Potentially as early as next year, but I would anticipate at least within the next couple of years.
Okay. And the data that we'd be gathering from testing now would be viable for foreseeable future, or
because the water table here is fairly stable, the constituents that we would be encountering are going to be fairly stable for the next couple of years, as long as we don't experience a major drought with a major drop in water. What we're testing for is all of the things that are naturally occurring that are basically yield killers. So if they're at a state now where they don't exist or they're low enough to be managed, then that becomes a viable area. And if they're too high, then we need to shy away from that.
Mm-hmm.
There is, as part of this, This is essentially the preliminary step to working towards applying for a grant for a well. If we discover a superb area to drill a well, but it's got one flaw, then some of these grants can be used to treat the water, and treating one flaw is definitely better than treating five. Or if it's another high in arsenic or high in nitrates situation, then we don't need any more of that.
So no more drilling wells on top of condemned wells?
It wasn't on top of it, it was 10 feet away from it.
Are you running any of the test sites on the east side?
We already have a little bit of data for the east side. The water on the east side is generally worse than the water on the west side. So most of this is filling in data from the west side. But we do have some water data from Jaylor and from our wells. And probably in the next couple weeks we'll have water data from the airport property, which I think we'll be able to pay for. But if after this we need additional data, then we might have to come back to the data. At this point, it looks like all that.
Board comments or questions?
Good to me. Public comment?
Nope. I would make a motion to approve.
Second.
Director Gregory?
Yes.
Director Compox?
Yes.
Director Callis?
Yes.
President Sangster?
Yes.
Passes 4-0 with one absent. What's that stuff?
Well, item 10.
So item 10, this was requested by Director Calvin. Would like to discuss any dates for a district strategic planning workshop. On Sunday, May 3rd, Director Calvin submitted a formal request to have an item placed on the agenda to address the district's long-term strategic planning. On May 15th, I met with Director Collins to review, discuss items, and address in a district long-term strategic plan and set dates for a workshop for all board members and the public to attend. Over the past few years, there have been several plans suggested by various groups that could improve the Sandy Hill community and its surroundings. The CSD has plans that meet requirements for water and wastewater and a general plan for the fire department, but the district has not vetted in a long-term general district strategic plan. This workshop is to establish a plan with timelines and set benchmarks that meet the district's needs and goals. Recommendation is to set a permit date for the district strategic planning workshop. And at this time, there's no financial impact for it. We suggest that this meeting is set after the August meeting, somewhere before the September meeting, simply due to time and the way our agendas are set up now. And so everybody knows there's a closed session special meeting set for June 11th at 6 o'clock here.
Direction to staff.
Will you guys make a decision in closed session?
What was direction to staff?
Now he's voiced what it is.
Okay. I just want to bring that up.
Okay, let me go back to when is it?
June 11th. Thursday, June 11th at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
So there's quite a bit of information, and I give Director Calvin a lot of credit for the research he's done. And due to the length of our agendas, it would be really hard to give the attention that the information you gather needed in a regular board meeting as an action item. So we're asking to set these workshops and truly anticipate more than one workshop, but it's going to give us the opportunity to truly digest the information that he's gathered and
I'll let you chime in on some of that stuff that you want. What I wanted to do with this action item right now is really just pin down a date for the workshop, and it would be very beneficial if we had a form for the board to donate.
Okay, can you count it?
Okay.
Who's attending the workshop?
It would be all board members, staff, I'm going to say public. We're going to invite Paso, we're going to invite county.
So we want it before the September meeting?
Yeah, we don't have room really for something that significant between now and probably the August meeting. We got to get through the first of the year with all the items that will be coming and our agenda's full. So we're thinking end of August, beginning of September.
So we can start the process in September, you know, or
September?
Yes.
Yeah, it's a public.
To the public?
Yes.
Okay. When there's three of you anywhere, it's always open to the public.
Okay. How about Thursday, September 10th?
I do want to say that with all the research that I pulled, I mean, there was at least 8 different documents I've been in the past 10 years involving the San Miguel community and the district. And when I was going back through who was putting their input in it, and I got to tell you, I was a little bit disappointed and a bit miffed. A little, Rob wrote, well, you wrote, you said it was a lot nicer than I would have said it.
Well, one part of this is that the information, as we talked to Director Calvin's, to make it available so we can kind of review and digest some of it before we go to the workshop, so we have a little bit of a foothold on the direction that you individually feel, and we can discuss like where we're at and where we need to go. We've talked a lot about different plans, and plans are great, but as soon as we put our rubber stamp on it, it seems like we get distracted or something sets it off course, and then we can't get back to it.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time you get back to it, it's no longer even part of the plan.
Right. So in the report, I suggested there's a different type of format. It's where you do, instead of doing a big old master plan that you spend a bunch of money on, because I know we talked about in the past, you spend the money, it looks great, it sits on a shelf, and it dies there. Like the San Miguel Community Plan is, I think, 400 pages long in and of itself, and it sits there on the shelf. The other format, which I can provide the information already to staff and everyone else, is doing more of like smaller projects that are very low cost. You can do 100 different projects, so you're not investing all your money in one thing, and you give opportunity, allow flexibility for staff to figure out what we all would like to do. That's kind of what the thought was in that.
The other part of it was, like you said, several groups have invested in a plan or came up with an idea, and the individuals involved were not even from this community. You know, they might be small town planners and they had good ideas, but they don't know our community and really what our needs are. They look at a small town and what maybe a small town needs.
Sure.
In my opinion, this town truly needs the resources to support the community, one being a true grocery store. They say this town won't support that yet. But with the plans that we have and in our strategic planning looking ahead of what we're going to develop out, I know Heritage Ranch built theirs, and I know it's really good for that community, and it spurred a lot of positive development over there. And they're not much bigger or than we are, so I truly believe that it would be supported here, and not just the district, but if you live anywhere on the east side or anywhere, you would come here to a grocery store if it was a true thing. And so those are just some of the things, and it's outside our purview as a CSD, but when we have a plan, you know, our water, wastewater, and then how we develop those to meet the needs that we're going to try to bring here, it's going easier. And I like the idea of it. I'd like to be with the people in the heart of town that are going to be here. They're going to be the ones that decide what we need, not someone from out of the area counting our parks saying we got nothing coming because we got a patch of grass somewhere, but we know nobody uses it now. Because it's like, there's a park over there. Okay.
Yeah, that was one example is the county has determined that Samuel's deficient in parkland by 11 acres. But even though that there's more parkland than that, the person who ever visited Samuel, they know these arbitrary numbers. And they put on impact fees, they take money out of our community, come put into a slush fund, then it goes elsewhere across the county. There's things like that happen all the time. And I think I got a headache trying to read all those documents, but what I would like is, if that's okay, is to pick the date, and then maybe I can, because I have all those documents, is that I can then send to staff, and you guys can then blast those out to the board members so that we can read at our own pace.
Well, a perfect example is this place was developed 20 years ago, CSD. And what Scott Young did with the permit process and the fire code is basically putting us in the eyes of the county. They're recognizing there's a governing body that is managing what's going on up here, and they don't take it upon themselves to make decisions for us and not even inquire if we want or don't want. And now that this group is more involved and we're being more proactive and we're learning more, we're finding, you know, we do need to educate them and we need to have a plan so they understand where we're at and they comply with it rather than stepping over us, giving us something we don't need and not giving us something we do need.
We need to control our own destiny.
Absolutely.
We need to have a path and we can, again, drive ourselves without their oversight as much.
I actually proposed September 10th.
You said Thursday, September 10th?
Mm-hmm. Yes,
I did.
Okay.
At 6.
Sure.
What?
So Thursday, September 10th, 6
yeah.
o'clock?
September 10th.
Have them release an MSR report without us really going into it.
Well, I haven't done anything with it anyway.
Okay. Good. I just, because I know that if that happens, they're going to say, oh, you need to do an MSR and then they have
well, just know that the ours was due, MSR and SOI.
Right.
Was due in 2018. They just got it to me last month.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really extensive. I mean, it's a big project.
Yeah.
And I plan on breaking it up.